good. How have you just seen Rosina and singing the song or asked to sing?
Actually, I haven't.
I do know more. I think it might be first or second.
Okay. I don't even print the program, but I'll get someone that's actually.
I'll just check in.
I didn't even get the program today.
Thank you. Thank you.
it's going to be done this morning.
Thank you.
Can we invite you to stand, please, brothers? Thank you, brothers and sisters. On behalf of the Po'olauva family, we want to welcome all of you out here this morning to this, the funeral service of Stuart Michael Gary Po'olauva. Presiding over the service will be President Ra Bacon, Stu's stake president from the Rotokari stake. My name is Bishop Willesi. I'm Stu's bishop. We'd like to also thank Brother Tongia for the prelude number. We'd like to commence this morning by singing on the hymn 227. There is sunshine in my soul.
following which Brother Tahi Brown will offer the opening prayer.
God, Papa, and Plato, thank you, long you. A long blessing lies, blow me, pla. He not me, pla. Walk about, long old blood road. I'm me, pla, come close to a long way. A long thing, I'm this long man. I'm lie down. Hello here, I'm Stuart. Plus, I've also this long man, I'm a good man. Me like him in Timas. God Papa, in up Yisalem Holy Spirit, and me come. Now me play. You like to now one bell. Me play like feeling peace. Now Holy Spirit, by making him this play peace, he come up. To bless him. You God Papa, long look at him. My problem. All family, all sin down. Blong Stuart. long this blood time. We pray ask him along, help him. This blood Lord to this play me better and blow me play. Now me lose him. Lord name, Lord Piggany, blow along Jesus Christ. Amen.
I think Brother Brown served with Stu in Papua New Guinea, so that'll give you an idea if you're wondering what language that was. It's really an honour for me to be here. I simply not just because Stu's in my ward, he's actually my executive secretary. And for those of you who don't know, what an executive secretary does is if anyone wanted to see the bishop, he has to call Stu. And if I wanted to see someone, I have to call Stu. So in other words, everybody in the ward knew who Stu was. And we refer to him as the glue. And I was very fortunate to be able to have him with us. And he just, everything just stuck together with him. And I really appreciate all the time that he served with me and also the bishop before me. He's been in this calling for the longest time. And he was just fantastic. There's no word to describe how wonderful his service was to the Heavenly Father. But because he loved the Lord more than anything else. We're just going to follow through if you have a program on you. We were first going to hear from, I'll just get my glasses, that might help. We will first hear eulogy from Kim Hirawani, sister, and then we'll hear from Book Smiler, his niece, and then followed by Ezra Hirawani, his nephew. And following them, we will have a family musical item.
Good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. Not liking the occasion, but it is a pleasure to be here with all of you. The last few days have been I think the most challenging in our family. Anyway, I've got to give the eulogy, which if the Bourne family can just shush when I get it wrong, because they're our other family. Stewie's, other family. So we learnt through the week when he wasn't with us, he was with them. And he loved them just as much as we loved him. Okay, Stewie was born December 11, 1974. And of course, I came first. I was the older sister, and he knew it. And then we had Isaac, who was next, who was his favourite. He looked up to Isaac in more ways than one, both spiritually and physically. We were all born to two awesome people, two Samoan people. A mother who has strong Samoan opinions and love, and a dad who's humble, loving, and keeps his wife happy. Happy wife, happy life. And my father knew that. And my mother loves him to no end. Okay. I was given the task of the eulogy, but I'm sorry, I wasn't very good at it. I didn't take the opportunity to look through all his journals and everything that he had. And you know what? He was a good executive secretary in his own life. He recorded everything. Everything was recorded. It was methodical. We just learnt so much about him this week. You know, he schooled in Tukuro. He went to Balmoral Primary School and then on to Tainui Intermediate. And then he went to Forest View High School, which from where we lived is on the other side of town. So I don't get why he got to go to Forest View when we had to go to Tukuroa High School. So I don't know what was so special about him, except as you've also learnt, he's the mummy boy. He is the mummy boy. He then came to Church College, and he always bragged about his older brother. See, what is that with the men in our family? They brag about the men and not about the beauties in the family. You know? Uncle Stewie, we heard he always talked about the boys, but never the beauties. So, yeah. But we know that's because he held us in high esteem and he didn't need to talk about us. He loved us. Okay, we had a pet dog. His name was Scruffy. And he was a little black thing with lots of fur and just followed us around. We had another dog, because Scruffy replaced Carrie, who was a Labrador, golden Labrador dog. And so they couldn't do without a dog, so they went and got a little Scruffy one. What else is there that I know about Stewie? Once he came to Church College, he prepped for a mission, and he went to Papua New Guinea. He was so excited about that, and he learned so many great things there. He definitely learned things. He saw things that were different, that were challenging, and we didn't learn about those things till later on in his life, how hard it was for him. The things that he saw there, the things that he couldn't do to change anything there. But he did what he could when he came home. What else was there? Then he went to school and he got his degree in social work. And so he got that. And I think it's evident through the week what we've learned about him in social work. The one thing that he got over Isaac, which he has rubbed in his face, is that he got the Queen Scout Award, and he and Isaac didn't. And Mum would always tell that to Isaac as well. He got the Queen Scout Award. What else do we have? He was reborn in 2004 when he met the Bournes. And we've learnt so much about the other family. In 2004 and up till now, they have been a big part of his life as well. And were evergreen. We are ever grateful to him. Okay, his favourite food was Mum's sweet and sour pork. And we used to hate rolling that sweet and sour pork, because we had to have it perfect. And back then, it was just pork, and we had to roll it and roll it and roll it because somebody wanted sweet and sour pork. So, and that grew his love for Chinese food. And just so you know, he is Chinese. He does have Chinese in him. Okay. We've heard that he loves M&Ms, and particularly when he's playing sports with his teams, the M&Ms are there. He never shared M&Ms with us. So it must be a born thing, because we never got the M&Ms. He loves sports, and being with Spy, the Bournes, he always had a team, either football, rugby, whatever it was. He was the guy that got everybody to come down and play, you know. He was the one to call up all the usos and nephews and, you know, to come, let's go play. He was the guy. He was the guy that did that. Okay, his first girlfriend. We heard a lot about that last night. Okay. Well, you'll have to find out for yourself who the first girlfriend was. Because it was, So, yeah. We'll let you find that out. Okay. And it was someone in this room. So, yeah. What else was there? We learnt that he used his degree, his heart, to help so many people. He was the father of so many children. He didn't have a family of his own as such, but what we've learnt this week is that he's touched and reached so many people, young, old. He was always... When he was young, he was always found playing with the kids. If cousins came over, all that sort of stuff, that's where he was. And you know what? He grew up and it didn't change. He always had time for the kids. Always. We've also learnt, these are things that he's really achieved and he's really good at. And that's a tongue selfie. Nearly every photo that we've got of Stewie is one with his tongue hanging out, whether it's with by himself or with the grandchildren or any children or his mates, the tongue is hanging out. So he's the king of the tongue selfies. We also learnt... that he was cheapskate. He especially at home, you know, we always wondered why there was only one light bulb in a chandelier that had like 6 to 8 bulbs. So Stewie's gone and we filled up all the light bulbs. So there's light. But then we thought it could be he's trying to create an atmosphere. So... we'll let you think on that. Because remember, Stewie was just at home by himself and dim lighting can help. He was an awesome connector. We thought we were special because we were Aloha Monday, Aloha Friday, and Aloha Sunday. But we found out half the world got the same Aloha. Monday or Friday. He connected with everyone. My cousins overseas, we just had our weekly catch-up. I don't know how he did it. I don't know how he kept up with everybody. He just did it. So I was a little bit offended because we weren't the favourites. We were just part of the big pot. So, but we missed our aloha text this morning. I don't know how we can replace that. The other thing that he was really good at was he knew everybody's birthday. He knew on his files, he has folders for every person that he knew that had photos, that he'd keep uploading, and then come birthday time, he was putting those photos up on the chats. He connected us. He did that every birthday, never failed. He had a video, music, and just, we all knew it was him. We knew that he loved his Heavenly Father. He, not just with his testimony, but he showed it in ways, quiet ways. In that way, he's like my dad. He was quiet. He was our background guy. He was my go-to guy. Stewie, can you do this? Stewie, can you do that? Now I got no Stewie. He was a loyal man, loyal to anyone that he met, and he made that connection. He was loyal. He loved the Lord. He loved the people. He loved his families. I know that we learnt through the week that this is definitely his time to go. We've all had, through the week, the family has had the whisperings of the Spirit through different members of the family. Let us know that it was his time and that he is happy, which is annoying, but he is happy. I know this is not a normal eulogy, but I just couldn't go through his stuff. I just couldn't. Because we were all just in shock, it was just too hard. But I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that we have felt the love of the Lord. There are people in this room who have just made this week so bearable. It has been an outpouring of love that we've never seen before. Never seen this before. It has been so good for our family. I have... We have had a lot of our mum and dad's family, and it's not, we've never had both sides of the family all together. And it's pretty cool. And all of them are itching to help, but there's nothing for them to do. And that's really unusual for us. There was absolutely nothing for them to do. There was nothing for us to do. We've felt that love. And that's just a testimony of how Stewie is. Because of him, we've been the recipients of the blessings of the people that he touched. And we will be ever grateful to those people. You are in our hearts. We love you. We need you in our life. after this week, we're even more connected. I want to leave my testimony because my mother's rolling her eyes. So, learnt a lot of secrets about Stewie, lots of good ones. Learnt a lot of things that have him that we never knew about him. And it was exciting to hear the stories and the love that everyone had for him, both the interesting and the loving ones. But we love you. I have a testimony that families are forever. I have a testimony in the plan of salvation, of the plan of salvation, that if we take hold of it, we can see Stewie again. We love you. I know my Saviour lives. I know this gospel to be true. And I humbly say these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Sit down.
So I'll follow the family tradition of getting the time of the day wrong and say good evening, brothers and sisters. So this is really daunting. If my glasses go down, it's just to support my emotional damage. So yeah, they might come down quite a bit. By way of introduction, my name is Brooke, and I... and the oldest child to Kim and Mike. Nana, the bubblegum is helping with my nervousness. I'm not taking it out. Don't tell me off. And I actually come from a long line of very opinionated Samoan women, so that's why Uncle didn't talk about us, because we talked about ourselves and you heard us anyway. Over the course of the last few days, that's what I've noticed. So my relationship with Uncle, Nana was his queen, Mum was his handler, and I was the princess. And that's something that I actually didn't really realise. Like, Uncle and I felt like we're always close. But over the last few days, I've heard from a few people that I actually was a favourite. So I'm going to live with that. Okay. So, when I thought about Uncle in the last few days, I could only but imagine him standing there. So for me, I'm going to bring his image back. And so I'll invite you now. You can close your eyes and you can imagine him, whatever it is you want to do or how you want to do it. But I felt like the many physical futures that he had brought about the quality attributes that he had. So, Uncle Stewie. We also have this, Aunt Kura knows, we have this like weird family voice when we see each other. So when I think Uncle Stewie, I'm like, Uncle Stewie! And that's how it was for us when we saw each other. So, okay, so Stewie. When you think of Stewie, and I'm thinking him from afar, he was not large in stature. He was short, you know, just under 6 foot short, no, five something. And I've learned over the last few days, as Mum mentioned, the families come together, that we actually get that from the To'o side, from Nana's side. But it seems like every other To'o apart from us got some height, so I don't know what happened there. Okay, and so as I imagine him, he's standing there, and, you know, Uncle's not tall. Going up, Uncle's legs were strong, grounded, well-travelled, and he always stood for something. His hands. His hands were used for sports, and they carried out the work given to him and brought about many miracles. Dewey had a barreled chest and broad shoulders, symbolic of his will, pride and sense of conviction in whatever it is that he did. He committed 1,000%. Uncle Stewie's mouth. Now, I bring this up because Stewie always told you what you needed to hear and never what you wanted. He also had an infectious, cheeky smile with a slight side grin on the end and the best laugh. That also carried the signature pose of his many selfies. Uncle Stewie's eyes. Over the last few days his family have come in, I've realised that he gets the eyes from his palaver side. And that is evident because they actually look like horsey eyelashes. They go straight down and they're thick and they're long and they're dark. And so you'll know the palavers because they all have the same eyes. Uncle Shui's hair, which apparently was his pride and joy, was neat and tidy, a representation of his organisation and cleanliness, a model of his home and how he lived. Uncle's house was never a mess, and Auntie was right. If the kids came over, if something was a mess or missing, Uncle was right behind us, putting it straight back where it needed to be. Might have got a side eye from them too. As I bid farewell to his physical vessel, I will identify him in heaven because of his heart, one that served him well and brought about many miracles. His heart was kind, empathetic, and compassionate. I find it only fitting that he passed from a high, that his heart was the first to go. In the Council of Heaven, before I came to this earth and before he came, I believe he met with me and we talked. And he promised me in our journey here on earth that we would work together. That he signed up to be my uncle. Now, Uncle and I have a different relationship. My husband said to me, I'd really like to hear some funny stories. And I said, oh, I don't have any. I was the niece that tested him. The lessons that Uncle promised to teach me were as follows. And I'll only highlight three of the most important that come to mind, because there were many. Number one, be the change in the world that you want to see. Uncle Stewie had the unique ability to befriend anyone. He didn't matter where you came from, what you did. You were a friend, and you were a friend to the end. And that seems to be evident in the last few days of what was shared. Everyone thought they were his best friend. And it didn't matter how old you were. The kids loved him as Uncle Stewie and knew him as that. It's evident in the texts, the selfies, the calls, every part of him that came. I know some people found that a little bit frustrating, but I actually loved it. I knew every Friday, every Sunday, and every Monday that I was going to get a text. And so I made a plan every once a week that one of those texts I would reply. Because I knew when they came, I knew where my uncle was and that he was good. I feared the day they wouldn't come. The second thing he taught me was forgiveness. Now, my family's going to remember this incident. Me and Uncle actually got into not a physical fight, but a disagreement on the basketball court. And Ezra will remember this. And Dad will remember this. I got really mad at Uncle, like really mad. I was so angry. And my dad sat me down and he counselled me. And he said to me, he shared the story about the Amish. And the story sort of goes that one of the Amish children ran out on the road or something and someone hit them. And the Amish community decided to forgive that person and just love them. And so I was really mad at Uncle, and he knew it because, not so subtle. And the next day, for the next 3 days, Uncle came over after work. And he brought me gifts. And I was so mad. Whenever he came, Dad would yell out to me, and he'd say, "Remember the Amish." And I would stand there and I was like, "I don't want to hear about the Amish. I'm going for a run." I would actually just run outside and just walk. But I was. It took me that long. It took me 3 days. And on the third day, I sat down next to Uncle and we talked it out. And that was probably for me the biggest example and the biggest lesson of forgiveness. The third... Whenever we would have family home evening or family council, Uncle Stewie's counsel was always to love your family. And that's been a huge part of who I am today. Uncle Stewie, I actually feel ripped off here. Because Uncle Stewie, I feel like everyone got an invite to things, but I feel like I started my own family and the invite stopped. And I'm like, oh, I'm feeling a bit cheated here. But I realised it was my turn to invite him. And so whenever I kind of had time or could make it work, I'd invite him. The last time I got to invite him, a friend from Hastings, she asked me to go at the Hucks. I don't know why my big mouth told her it was so cool to go up. It was not cool. And I rang Uncle at 6:30 in the morning, and I was like, oh, he might be busy. And I was like, nah, stuff it, I'll just ring him. So I rang Uncle, and I was like, hey, Uncle, what are you up to? And he's like, oh, nothing. I was like, oh, you want to come up the Hucks? And he said, oh, yeah. And I was like, oh, dang. No, I have to go. But I invited him because I knew he'd bring the hype that I needed to get up there, because I was already like, nah, I don't want to go. So I was so grateful he came that day. And then we went and shared breakfast. So in closing, they say it takes a village to raise a child. But I think it takes a village to bury one too. He was given to us as his family. But he chose all of you. I think the reason why he didn't marry here is because so many other people needed him. And they needed his light, and they needed his love. So say goodbye to your physical body, Uncle. When I get there, I know you'll be there. You never miss an appointment, never. I'm grateful for you, for everything that you've taught me, for being such a big hand in my upbringing and who I am today. I'd just like to close with my testimony, that I know the church is true, that I know it's through the plan of salvation that I'll see you again. And as we strive to live worthily, from what you taught us, we'll make it back. Go well, Uncle. I'm so proud of you. I'm glad you get to do this for you. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Morning, te whānau. Apologies for my family. As you've learned, they can't tell the time. And also, when you hear the word lastly or just in closing, there's probably another story to come. So, but I'll keep it short. It's turning into a bit of a state conference, but I'm a bit more punchier than my whānau. But for those who don't know me, my name's Ezra, and I'm Stewie 0.2. He knows it. I know it. I was faster, fitter, stronger than Uncle Stew. When he moved in, when I was 10, into our little place in Rossay, Mum said, Uncle Stu's going to come live with us. And I was like, yes. And then she said, he's actually going to stay in your room. And so I went to bed at 5 o'clock that night, and I told Uncle, like, you're on the top bunk, my cuz. You know, get up there. And I just watched him just lay there on my bed and just watch Uncle climb up. And every night I go to bed at 5 o'clock so he wouldn't steal my bed. So he knew, so everyone talks about being Uncle's favourite. Uncle was my favourite. He was that guy for me. Brooke talks about, you know, she got accidentally tunnelled at basketball. That was the experience. And Uncle came over and they started getting into it a little bit. And it wasn't until I grabbed Uncle by the collar and said, watch your mouth. Sit on the bench, Uncle. It's okay, Ez, okay, Ez. But I'll miss my uncle. I love him heaps, and I kind of like to cry in public, but I'll cry with my whānau, so my whānau know that I'll always be here, and I'll fill the gaps that uncle left. I'll fill his car. I'll fill his clothes. Liam, if you have any more hand-me-downs, bro, I'll fill those too. And so it's a bit of a hole that he's going to leave in our whānau, but I know one day it'll be made whole again if we stay true to the gospel principles and do everything that we need to find our way back to Uncle. But yeah, I love you, Unc. And me and Uncle kind of had like a Toy Story kind of relationship, you know, like Woody and Andy. But the only thing was, As we grew older, I became Andy, and Uncle was Woody. And Britty was Buzz. But I started to find other things that occupied my time, and so he'd always come over and ask us to play for the Hawks. And I think out of all those games, we watched half of one. And then he asked us to come play Prezzies with him, and I have... I have arthritis now because of that game that I said yes to. And so, but yeah, as the years grew on, Uncle always kind of asked me and Livy to go and do stuff with him, but we always declined. And it's one of those things that I'll regret now, and I'll try my best to make up to one day. And the way that I'll make it up, Uncle, I left my ring in there for you, bro. And when you're ready, and when you find the wire that will make you happy, I'll do your work for you. Now, the night Uncle passed, I just got my temple recommend interview renewed. By choice, not through sin. I was just lazy. And a brother, I just heard what I was saying after I found out that Uncle was gone. He'd probably would have taken away, so it's good timing. But I love you, my Uncle, and I'll see you once again. To my whānau, I'll be here. When we clean up his whare, I'll be here. And Nana and Papa, it's been really tough staying with Uncle and watching you cry at night. I can't imagine a greater pain than having to bury one of your tamariki. And so I'll do my best to help carry the load. But I know that God lives and that he loves us. That he's willing to do all that he can to help us see Uncle again if we're willing to put our faith in his son, Jesus Christ, and make the steps necessary to be able to turn home. I look forward to taking you back down to Tokoro, Uncle, and sending you home like the king you are. I see these things in the name of Christ. Amen.
One thing I was always grateful for Stu for is that I thought my Samoan was bad until I met Stu. And his was the worst than I was, so thanks for that, Shu. Going along with our program, we will now hear from Edna and Livy, mum and dad, following which we'll hear from Brother Clive Bourne, and then we have an inserted musical item by Luann, and then following her, we'll hear from Isaac Polava, and then following Isaac, another musical item.
Hello, Palaba, my brothers and sisters. Good to be back to Hamilton. We just come from A1 steak, Rotorua steak. And it's good to be here to see all our old friends who used to be coming to the temple. We welcome you all in this special occasion on our little boy, and then he's still running around with no girlfriend, but now he's gone. He tried to follow my other brother's ideas, because I have a brother, he was serving in Air Force in America, and he's retired from there before he got a girlfriend in Samoa. And he look after the pay for the old people, so I always joking to him on the phone that when my pay comes, he let me know so I can come to Samoa. It's blessed to be here today. Thanks for all of you for supporting this occasion of our
son.
Our son and our Kaumatua and his pastor. Blessed to see all our old friends used to come to the temple, and thank you very much for attending this special occasion for us. For furthermore, I pass the time to my Kaumatua.
You can see that my husband is not a person that liked to stand in front of people and talk. But when he was in the bishopric in our ward, he had to get up and talk to our ward, in front of our ward. I am so grateful to stand before you at this time. I have to try not to cry. And to say a few words about my son. My son, he is next to perfect. And I knew if I say that, my daughter will roll her eyes. So that's why I said it. But I love my children equally. I don't love more than the other one. It's true. Mothers love all their children the same. But my daughter always say, oh, Mum, Stuart's her favourite. Yes, Kimmy, and you're my favourite too when you're the oldest child that was born to the world first. I'm so grateful to be able to be here. And it's so beautiful to see all of you here.
I didn't realize that my son knows so many people. My heart swelled up last night when we were at the family service, and the chapel was full right to the back. And so my son has done a lot of missionary work still as he worked for Clive. He loves Clive's family very much. When Clive's mother was sick and Stuart was home at the weekend, and when Clive let them know that Emma was had a stroke, my son said to me, "Mom, Clive just let me know that Mama Emma had a stroke." And I said, "Well, you need to go, son." He came out the room crying. And I thought to myself, he loves Emma so much. Emma was his second mother. And of course, he should be his second mother because he spent all his time with Clive and their family because he lived here in Hamilton. And sometimes it's hard for him to come home because he's busy, but he does make time to come home to see me and his father. We love our son so much. And I'm lost for words. But I'd just like to say to you, he has been a wonderful son. Anything that happened in our family, he's always the first to be there. He comes and he's so wise. Father and I are not people that we sort of communicate with things that we had to sort of think it out first. But Stuart, he helped us to make up our mind, to make the decisions, to do the thing that is happening in those times. I am going to miss him so much, same as my husband. I try to live my life so that both of us, because we are forever family, so that we try not to do the opposite to being faithful in the gospel, so that our children will follow the teaching of the gospel of our Savior, Jesus Christ. When we were serving our mission at the temple, we continued to, the time was up. At the time, when we were serving our mission at the temple as running a restaurant, people didn't want to come in and serve a mission at running the restaurant. I guess because it's at the time, they don't pay people anymore to come in and run the restaurant at the temple. So 2 years after, 5 years after, 7 years after, 10 years after going to 11, Brother and Sister Pulava were still serving at the temple. But we were grateful for the opportunity that we have served for the Lord in those years. And we got to meet so many people and they became our friends. And even today, those people are still remembering us and give their love to us. But I just want to say this. If you are called to serve for the Lord, we all need to be faithful and be able to continue to serve. And my father, my parents, when they were here on the earth, they always say to us, don't shame the gospel. Make sure that you live up to all the teaching of the gospel. And I try my best through my life to do so, so that my children will follow with their hearts to be near the Savior always. I don't know what they say, but they said, "Oh, Mum, don't be too hard on us." But because I was brought up with parents that were strict, and because they love the gospel, he wants us to make sure that we live the gospel to its fullness. I see many of my friends here today. I'd just like to say to you, you are my true friends. When we're serving at the temple, I see some of you here today. And I have loved you, and it's so wonderful to be able to see you come up and say that you love us still. My children are looking up at me, and I think they don't want me to talk too long. And I can see my daughter laughing down there. What can I say, Kimmy? What do I say? Yeah, we love the Lord.
Time's up.
My husband said my time is up. Bishop, is my time is up? I can talk as long as I like. It's my son's. It's my son's funeral service. And I can talk as long, I can keep everybody here for another hour. My son Isaac said, Lai. But are we singing our song after us? Oh. Anyway, I just like to say to my grandchildren, my grandson, Israel, Israel is okay. I'm just going to say that I love you all. And I'm so grateful to my nephew for being here. As soon as my nephew knew that my son has passed, Joseph Skip is my sister's son. He's always been at my right hand every time things happen. And he said to me, I'm on my way. This is the only family that I have, Joseph, isn't it? That always close by to come. I better finish as everybody's going like this and moving around. But I'd just like to say thank you so much for all the love that you have given our family throughout this weekend. I didn't know that my son was so popular with everybody. But I see that he must have done the right thing by loving everybody and serving them, all of you. I just like to say that I love you all and thank you so much for everything. And I pray that Heavenly Father's blessing be upon us for the rest of the day till we go home and bury him in Tokoro. And I say this thing in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. I'm sorry, I have a terrible sore leg.
Every day, every day, Monday right through to Sunday, Stu and I, we meet at the back of the farm. We've got our own little special place where we sit and talk and gossip about everybody and talk stink about them. And one thing Stu used to have, so he was organized, he had little ringers for all of you. Everybody in here had a different ringer. I got to learn them after a while. And when certain ones would go and he'd just message you that I'm still clocked in at work. It's about midnight. And I know when there was a Hawaiian one, that was Rachel, and he'd never answer. never answer her call. But anyway, just some quick little moments. I like this story because it's pretty much wraps me and him up. When our sons decided to get married and a couple went on missions, Stu and I were left with trying to be farmers on the farm. And so there was a stockyard, and we'd have to inject the cows every 6 months for worms. And so he learned how to do it, and he got pretty confident. I'd stand on the top with the backpack and the injection, and he'd come from the back. And I remember one time he showed off, and some little calves came through, and he put his shoulder behind him and touch, pause, engage, and started pushing his little calves through. And I'd give them an injection, and I was looking, and I was like, the animal started getting bigger, but he was confident. He went down and he goes, touch, pause. When he pushed it through, the cow gave him a big boot and he went flying. The only problem was I fell over and I injected myself with Roundup, and I ended up A&E, me and him up there checking if I had worms. Anyway, we used to coach rugby, or we tried to, and he was a good coach, and I used to just tag along, and we had Bones join us sometimes too. And I remember we were coaching a church college team, and we were to play Hamilton Boys High, and they just finished being the under 16 Australasian champions, and we just had our kids from the college. And so me and Stu decided we'll contact Brother Horry Solomon, and he might be able to toughen up our boys. And so we got Horry in, and he gave us a hand, and then I said, well, we've got to do more than this. So what Stu and I used to do, we'd go on our van and video, we'd video boys' high practices. And I'd walk around like I was a parent at the training, and we learn all their line out calls and all their back moves. And so we beat them. Anyway, and I really love coaching with Stu and Bones. You know, they were great coaches, but they gave me such great self-esteem because they're the first two guys that are shorter than me. Another quick one. They put me on the High Council for some reason, and I was there for a while, and I'd always like going to Kawhia and Tauramanui and Tikawiti and those other areas. And Stu knew I had a problem with driving. For some reason, I start falling asleep now when I drive. So Stu would say, hey, Toko, I'll drive you to your High Council talk. I said, well, thank you so much. And he drove me out to Kawhia, and Brother Albert Kiwini was there, and I talked to Brother Kiwini, and then I sat down, and she said, why are you sitting beside me? I said, that's nicer here. I can feel the spirit. Anyway, after all the sacrament was done, President Kiwini got up and he says, Brother Bourne has told us that President Pongai has sent a special guest speaker for us today. And his brother Stu Palava is going to speak to us on self-reliance. So Stu ended up speaking for me. What's another quick one? One more. Just recently, I wasn't feeling too good. Anyway, and I told him, hey, man, I'm feeling pretty lousy. And he used to say to me, you're pathetic. He'd say that to me. And I said, well, what shall we do? And he said, I'm going to come pick you up in the morning. We're going to the temple. And I said, no. Last time you took me to the temple, President Pongai saw me and I got stuck being a bishop. So we're not going to the temple when the church leaders are around. We've got to go when they're not there. And so he worked out a schedule for me and him to go do initiatory work when the church leaders weren't around, so we wouldn't get a calling. But anyway, that's just some fun stuff with Stu, and I'm sure you had a lot of fun stuff, but yeah, you fellas come up and sing. Listen to the words in the scripture. I think it sort of tells us a bit about Stu.
Gone forth into the way, there came one running and kneeled to him and asked him, "Good master, what shall I do that I may inherit eternal life?" And Jesus said unto him, "Why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, that is God. Thou knowest the commandments: do not commit adultery, do not kill, do not steal, do not bear false witness, defraud not, honor thy father and mother." And he answered and said unto him, "Master, all these things have I observed from my youth." Then Jesus, beholding him, loved him, and said unto him, "One thing thou lackest: go thy way, sell whatsoever thou hast, and give to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven. And come, take up the cross, and follow me." And he was sad at that saying, and went away grieved, for he had great possessions.
See you soon.
It's still morning, so good morning, brothers and sisters. I'm grateful for this opportunity to share a few thoughts. I'll be really brief because we failed already for Stuart. We were late to the family service. We were late to his funeral service. So I want to try and make sure that we're not late to his burial service. I feel very humbled to stand before you and talk a little bit about my brother. Over the last couple of days, many stories have been shared about my brother Stuart. And he was a bit of a character, you know. And I think last night when we were having our drinks, the stories started to flow. And you could hear the many stories of what my brother got up to and how many people he touched in his life. I had a talk all sorted, but I'm going to just reduce it to 3 minutes. I stand here in awe over my brother. I feel privileged to be called Stuart's brother. I stand in awe to know that my brother was humble. He was meek and he was loving. I stand here to express my gratitude and my love to my brother. He was loyal to his family and to his friends. My brother has left a big hole in my heart. To me, he was always my hero. I pray now that I may step up and be all in for my family. My brother's an egg. He left me. I told him he was an egg. To my nieces and nephews, I will strive to step up. I can never replace Uncle Stewie, and I never want to replace Uncle Stewie. But I will try and be a better uncle to each and every one of you. To my children, I love you and I'm grateful for you. To Mum and Dad, looks like I'll have to come and drive you around now. You'll have to come and stay in Tauranga. I will strive to be good and step up. That's enough for me. To Clive and his family, we love you. We will always be grateful for the love that you shared with Stuart. I didn't realise he worked for 19 years with you guys. That's a lifetime. But we love you as a family. And hopefully we can continue to stay connected. I want to bear you my testimony, brothers and sisters, that I know that God lives, that Jesus Christ has made it possible for each and every one of us to be together forever with our families. I know that this church is true. I know that Stuart knew that the church was true. May we continue to move forward. Don't look back. Strive to be better people than we are today. I love you all. I love my family. And I say these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Gee, I even remember singing that hymn when I was at home. We want to thank all those who have participated in our Stu's funeral service thus far. Stu would have to be one of the very few person that I know that can teach the gospel without even saying one word. We will now hear from Joseph Skibbs, his cousin, and then we'll hear some closing remarks from President Bacon, Stu's stake president.
Brothers and sisters, it's a delight to be here this morning. This is my first time in this building. It's a marvelous building to be here in the shadows of the temple, and I'm so grateful to be here. I'm Joseph Skibbs. My mother and father were Alice Skibbs and Eddie. And their parents, or my mother's parents, and mum was Auntie Edna's sister, but my grandparents were Leone Rivers and Isaac or Uncle Rivers. And wonderful to see so many of you here. And on my grandmother's side, there were the Tors and the Browns. And on my grandfather's side, there were the Rivers, the Amu, and the Schwenkies. And so this connection of families is immense. I can't help but think of my childhood days. I had the opportunity of living with my grandparents for a short period of my life. Those formative years as a child living here in Temple View as labor missionaries. And so I have images of riding the lawnmower with my grandfather, mowing the lawns at the temple grounds here, and then coming back as a student at Church College, and then remarkable memories that I have of this place. So I feel home. I acknowledge those that have been here for many years and have contributed to my life. And so many may be wondering, oh, how is he connected to the Polavas? Well, I express my love to the Polavas on behalf of my family. I have some of my family here today. And particularly to Auntie Edna's sister, Auntie Angie, who is zooming in from Utah, and to her younger brother, Lee, who's watching from Brisbane, and so many of the other family that are watching from around the world. I've felt the love of the Lord and felt gratitude in my heart as we have gathered. It's been a remarkable time. We enjoyed the family service last night, but then as we met as a family to farewell to Stuart and his mortal tabernacle this morning, as we closed the casket and as we had the opportunity of sharing some tender moments, I felt so proud of my Polava family for the heritage and the love which they have for each other and for the influence which they have had in our lives as we've grown up together. Life is, and I had a few thoughts, and I want to keep them brief so that we might be able to hear from President as he gives his closing remarks. But one thing is sure, that when we were born, that we will all die. But this is just a period of probation, a period where we will prepare to dwell and live eternally with our Heavenly Father once again. I'm just overwhelmed with the influence that Stuart has had. When he passed, they told me he was playing netball. And we've heard some wonderful stories. I said to Isaac and Kim, what position was he playing? And I don't know if it was true, but I think they said he was playing goal shoot. And with his height, I said, my goodness, goal shoot. He should have been playing center. But as I reflect upon Stuart's life, he was always striving to be a little taller, to be a little stronger, to be a little better. And he had a great love of the Savior. But we've heard some wonderful doctrine taught to us over these services that we've had. I reflect on William Wordsworth, the great poet laureate. Our life is but a sleeping, a forgetting. But our life star that riseth cometh from afar, not another nakedness or forgetfulness, but trailing clouds of glory do we come from God, who is our home. And so as we commemorate and as we celebrate his life, I hope and pray that I know that I will go from here being a little more humble and being a little bit more with conviction in my heart, that I will do the very best that I can to be able to be worthy to live and dwell with my Heavenly Father once again. As we close the casket, we had the last opportunity, Auntie Edna and Uncle Levy, to bid farewell to their son, knowing that they will see him again. But what a wonderful reminder. Here we are at the foot of the temple, that as we honor our covenants, that as we keep the Savior as the center of our lives, we will dwell together as families eternally. I bear witness that God lives, that we are not perfect, but because of his Son, because of his atonement, and because of his great resurrection, his divine birth, his incomparable life, that we have the opportunity of dwelling with our Father in heaven once again. Once again, as I close, I express my love, particularly to Auntie Edna and to Uncle Levy, from my family, from my immediate family, my siblings, from across the seas. And but we love you. And to Kim and to Isaac and to their families, we express our love. May we continue to do the best we can. God loves us. There is a plan for us, which Isaac's told us about. I leave these blessings and my thoughts with you, and do so in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
The Savior said to be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. And that's what Stewie is going to say to us also today, is to be of good cheer. He would want us to celebrate his life, to know of his love, and to hope that each of us can feel it. Many of us have never met the Saviour Jesus Christ in person or had an opportunity to see his smile, a look into his eyes, or to feel the love that he has for us. But every single one of us that has known Stu has had a little bit of a taste of that, to know what it's like to be greeted by him, to know what it's like to have that warm smile, the look and the feeling of love, pure love. The Saviour says, I go to prepare a place for you in the mansions of my Father. I know without doubt that that is the destiny and arrival place for Stuart Polava, that he will indeed be received into the kingdom of God. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Stewie not only chose to come unto Christ, but he stayed with him. He walked with him. And what a beautiful invitation that he's blessed all of our lives to be able to do the same, to follow the Saviour, to follow Stuart Polava. As we walk with the Lord, stay in the way and come and follow him, we will all be united with Stewie again. You will even be blessed, many of you, to be able to be encouraged on your path as you continue to walk forward by his very Spirit coming to visit you and encouraging you in your life's journey as much as he's encouraged you in mortality. He's got a work to do. He's going to go on and have much joy in the steps that lie ahead of you, but he will come at times to comfort you and encourage you, just as the Saviour would and does. I know the gospel of Jesus Christ is the true gospel, that only through and following him can we receive and achieve eternal joy in the kingdom of God. I leave my witness of these things and love for this man who has taught us, each of us, how and what we should do in this life. I pray that we can follow him and follow our Saviour Jesus Christ. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Our closing hymn, brothers and sisters, will be hymn number 294, There is Beauty All Around, following which Brother Nehana Jacob has been invited to offer the closing prayer.
Thank you. Our most righteous eternal Father in heaven, as we gather here to celebrate, reflect and remember the life of our friend, our brother, Stu, we are grateful for all that have been shared through word and music. We pray, Father in heaven, that thou will strengthen mother and father at this time, that thou will strengthen and comfort the palava, toa and born whānau as they stand in need of comfort and a mourning, that we may be here to support them. We're grateful for the testimonies that have been born of the atonement of thy Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. And we are truly grateful, and we know and believe that families can be together forever. We pray now, Father, as we close this service, that thou will strengthen us, and that those of us who remain in this tabernacle mortal clay, that we may carry on the Aloha Fridays, Sundays and Mondays as Stu would want, so that we may all reach out to each other and love one another. We pray that as we travel to take Stu back to Tokoro along State Highway 1, that those of us who will follow in the procession may do so safely, that no harm or danger may befall us on the roads, and that as we lay him in his final burial place back home, that we may feel of thy love and thy spirit this day. Is our humble prayer we say in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
What's going to happen, brothers and sisters, that Stu's body's going to remain here for a little bit before they head down to Tokoroa. That'll give some of you that haven't had the opportunity to come and visit with him. There will be some light refreshment at the very back in the kitchen area there for everyone to enjoy. And so you're welcome to come and just spend some time with Stu, because then they'll take the body down to Tokoroa. And we're looking at leaving at around about 1 o'clock or just before that. Thank you, brothers and sisters.
Thank you. actually, he's passing out, and then I'll come back for him. Promise.